Welcome to TED Countdown at COP26, the third of our three sessions. At the end of, I know, another very long day here in the Blue Zone at COP. Thank you for being with us in the studio, and thank you all those of you who are joining us online. My name's Lindsay Levin. This is my colleague, Bruno Giussani. We're part of the TED Countdown team. We're really excited to welcome you tonight. For those of you who may not be familiar with Countdown, I'll just very quickly give you a sense of it. We got together a couple of years back, TED and the power of TED Talks and all the work that they do with an organization that I lead, a network called Future Stewards. And we brought together the power of storytelling with thinking about leadership and how systems change happens. And the whole driver behind Countdown is the idea of how do we amplify and accelerate examples of solutions to climate change. So that's what we've been doing. We've built up a portfolio of many, many talks. We had a summit 3 weeks ago when we shared a great number of wonderful solutions from right across the world. And we're going to give you a little sample of those tonight. So over to you, Bruno, to introduce our first talk.
Yes, today at COP, the theme of the day was nature and particularly land. And when we think of land, generally, we think of the features above land. We think of trees and flowers and vegetables. And we tend to overlook the thing on which we stand, the soil, which is by itself a big potential climate solution. And that's what the first talk is about the solution under our feet. And the speaker is a scientist. She's an ecosystem scientist. Please welcome Jane Zelikova.
Under our feet, there is an unseen world more diverse than all the tropical rainforests combined. Teeming with microbial life and critters large and small, this hidden world of soil is on every single continent. But most of us know little to nothing about this vast world under our feet. And for most of my life, I was no exception. I grew up as a very curious and adventurous kid. I spent a lot of time climbing trees and falling out of them, and I spent a lot of time getting really dirty. In college, I had to take a class for a science requirement, and I was shocked to discover that being really curious and loving dirt could be a legitimate career. So it took no convincing whatsoever for me to change my major, and that's how I became an ecologist. In graduate school, I studied how the loss of a seed disperser, in this case, the winnow ant, affected the plants that they disperse. In my research site, we were discovering that these ants were moving up in elevation to escape a rapidly changing climate, but they were leaving the plants they dispersed behind. So while I came to grad school to study ants, I all of a sudden found myself studying climate change. And because ants nest in soils, I had to learn a lot more about soil. What I couldn't have predicted as that young, curious, budding ecologist was that I would spend the next decade of my life thinking about the invisible army of soil microbes and how we can harness their awesome powers to help address climate change. But before we get to all of that, let's start at the beginning. Soils are considered to be the skin of the earth. They're only a few meters thick, but they support all agriculture and every single terrestrial biome. Soils help protect our food supply, clean our water, boost our immune systems, and they serve as a source for some critical medicines, including many that have yet to be discovered. Without Earth's exceedingly thin layer of soil and its multitude of organisms, we would not eat, and humanity as we know it may not exist. And soils, like many good things, they take time to develop. They form over hundreds to thousands of years as rocks break down and plants and animals decompose. As soils form, they accumulate and store carbon. In fact, There are billions of tons of carbon stored underground, 2 to 3 times more than what we have in the atmosphere. Plants and soil work in collaboration to drive the single most important transformation of carbon on this planet, photosynthesis. Plants take carbon dioxide from the air and they combine it with water and sunshine to create sugars and, of course, to grow plants. Plants and their sugars eventually decompose in the soil, feeding the microbes. In fact, most of the carbon that comes in through plants ends up in soil at some point. The carbon cycle continues. Microbes and their carbon eventually break down, and the carbon from the microbes sticks to soil particles, creating what we call soil clumps or aggregates, because microbial carbon is sticky. So when that microbial carbon ends up in a clump, it's physically protected from further decomposition. And what we know now is that the majority of soil carbon that is sequestered is actually dead microbes, or what we call microbial necromass. That necromass can stick around in soils for decades to millennia, especially if we leave soils undisturbed. But over the last 12,000 years, we have lost billions of tons of carbon from our soil. As humans converted grasslands and forests into agricultural fields and rangelands, building roads and cities. One of the major drivers of that loss was the plow, which at the time was a major technological breakthrough that really revolutionized agriculture and altered the trajectory of human history. With each pass of the plow, those plant roots and soil aggregates that we know are really important are broken apart, exposing carbon to decomposition. Today, we use more than a third of our land to feed and clothe billions of people on this planet. But we're losing our soils at an alarming rate, and with it, we're losing their fertility. Without that soil, it's going to be a lot harder to feed what is going to be close to 10 billion people on this planet by 2050. That's going to put a lot more pressure on what is already a disappearing and resoundingly underappreciated resource. There is no machine that can bring soil back. No technology that can do what thousands of years of rock weathering and biological activity have achieved. But we can build our soils and put more carbon underground with a little help from plants and microbes. Rebuilding soil is going to require us to fundamentally rethink our reliance on technology and chemicals to deliver what soils can do on their own, support life. And life in soil is mostly microbial. The Dutch scientist Antoni van Leeuwenhoek saw tiny organisms he called the wee beasties under his microscope about 350 years ago, and with the rapid innovation of molecular and computational tools, we are finally getting a sneak peek at who they are and how they make their way in the world. Here's the thing, a teaspoon of soil holds billions of organisms, things like bacteria, fungi, protists, and archaea. These organisms, these microbes, are the movers and shakers of nature's carbon cycle. They drive really important processes in soil. They take organic matter and convert it into complex carbon molecules. And having more carbon in soil is transformative. As carbon accumulates, agricultural fields can hold on to more water and more nutrients, building resilience that helps them deal with the ups and downs of a changing climate. That resilience means plants can grow more consistently, even when the weather is fickle. And the awesome thing is, carbon-rich soils help buffer us against what is an uncertain climate future. The trick is to really rethink how we do agriculture. So there is the good news, which is there are some tried and true ways that we can get more carbon in our soils and build our soils back. We can plow less, and we can make sure that we have roots in the ground year-round, feeding the microbes and powering that microbial engine humming under our feet. And we can do this. The other thing is diversity is the key ingredient in this recipe. Diverse plant communities support diverse microbial communities that can transform and store more carbon. Diversity is good for soils and is good for climate mitigation. Just like we need every microbe, we need every farmer and rancher, every climate solution, and every solver. So, healthy carbon-rich soils matter today more than ever. The other great thing about carbon-rich soils is they help farmers have more consistent agricultural operations and more sustainable ones that can withstand the ups and downs of a changing climate. That's a huge win for the people that grow our food. It's a win for climate, and it's a win for us consumers. So how do we do it? Well, there are three simple things we can do. Number one, we have to protect our soils and the carbon they already hold. Number two, we can get more carbon underground by growing diverse, climate-adapted crops. And number three, we can let the microbes do their thing, leave them alone, by leaving the soil undisturbed. It sounds simple, and that's because it kind of is, but there are some questions that are left to be answered, and there's a lot of room for us to innovate. We need to track and measure our climate progress. We need to develop more climate-resilient crop varieties that can grow deeper roots and pump carbon underground deeper. And we need to rethink our economic models in agriculture and help support and incentivize these carbon-sequestering agricultural practices. So lots of room for innovation, lots of room for research. Good news for us scientists. But we don't have time to waste. Climate change is here, and it's affecting all of us, whether we know it or not. It's affecting every single ecosystem, including agriculture. Soils are the literal foundation of life on this planet. The reason that we can eat, and a climate solution just waiting to be unlocked. So, let's build back our soils, help our planet, by looking down to the ground. Thank you.
So, soils absorb carbon, as do forests. But we've left solving this problem so late that it is likely we're also going to need to find mechanical ways, develop mechanical ways of drawing down carbon, of removing carbon. The next talk is going to give us a spectrum of that, both what we need to do in terms of carbon removals with nature, but also what some of the mechanical alternatives might be. It's a scary topic to many of us and an opportunity to hold an open mind. I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker. She's actually also in the room, so you can catch her later, but we're going to listen to this beautiful talk from the founder of Valence Solutions, Gabrielle Walker.
This is a woolly pig. She's gorgeous, obviously. And she's also one part in a whole new set of approaches for dealing with climate change. They are all called carbon removals. And they all involve taking CO2 out of the sky and storing it somewhere safe. I'll come back to the woolly pig later. But first, why do we need carbon removals? Because I know what you're thinking. Isn't it easier to stop putting the carbon in the atmosphere in the first place? And the answer is, yes, of course, it is. We have to do everything we can, as fast as we can, to stop carbon getting into the sky and stop climate change getting worse. That should not be a controversial point of view at this meeting. But the problem is, we've left it too late. We can't now do it fast enough. I've been working on climate change for more than 20 years, and I've talked about it in boardrooms and classrooms and everywhere in between, and I was shocked when I found this out, but the science is utterly, utterly clear. If we're going to have a fighting chance of staying below 1.5 degrees, that safe limit, we have to have carbon removals. And it looks like we're going to need a lot. Scenarios from the Energy Transition Commission, from the International Energy Agency, from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change have all shown that we're going to need billions of tons of carbon removals between now and 2050 to give us a chance of staying below 1.5 degrees. We're going to need both reductions and removals. But there's another more heartening reason why we need carbon removals. They also give us a chance, our only chance, not just to stop the problem getting worse, but to make it better. Because even 1.5 degrees isn't actually safe. We're not there yet, and we're already experiencing the fires and the floods and the droughts and the storms. With carbon removals, we can take our historical emissions out of the atmosphere. We can clean up the mess we've made, and we can give our world a chance to heal. So what do the removals look like? Well, I've been talking to a lot of people lately about carbon removals, from business executives to climate activists, and they tend to go one of two ways. They either think of trees, or they think of big futuristic machines. Nature versus tech, green versus chrome. But the more I've dug into carbon removals, the more I've realized this is not the right way to think about them. Because the world is full of ways to store carbon. You can store it in trees, you can store it in soils, you can store it in the ocean, you can store it in buildings, you can store it in rocks, you can store it deep underground. And every one of those approaches requires some combination of natural resources and human ingenuity and technology. We're going to need both nature and technology. I'll show you what I mean. So if we start on the natural end of the spectrum with trees. Now, I still find it astonishing that every single tree and plant on Earth has made its entire body directly from carbon in the air. They are incredible carbon capture machines, and we're going to need a lot more of them. But we also have to do it right. Because if you put trees in the wrong place, they burn. We have to put trees in places where they foster biodiversity, where they don't compete with food for land, and where science and technology tell us they are likely to survive even in the face of climate change. Now, if you don't want that CO2 from the burning trees to get into the sky, you can actually burn the wood deliberately in a power station, capture the CO2 and bury it in a process known as BECCS, which also gives you energy as a sideline. But if you want to keep the carbon locked up in the wood, there are technological ways to do that as well. Like this one, look at this. A whole new movement to use wood as a building material in modern high-rise buildings. And that's a good idea for at least three reasons. First of all, you know, it keeps the carbon locked up in the wood. Secondly, it displaces high-emitting materials like concrete. And thirdly, the buildings are gorgeous. You can also use technology to help carbon stay locked up in soil. Storing carbon in soil sounds like a good idea, and it is a good idea. The question is, how long does the carbon stay there? Because if you change your agricultural practices for 1 year, 2 years, that's fine. But if you ever go back to the old ways, the carbon goes back up into the sky. That's where this stuff can help. It's called biochar, and you make it by taking wood and burning it in the absence of oxygen until you get this. It locks the carbon up in the wood, and now it can't burn away. Now, it turns out that biochar is very good for soils. In fact, indigenous people in the Amazon have been using it for generations to improve the quality of their soil. We can do that on a much bigger scale, improve the soil, and lock up carbon. That's nature and technology and indigenous wisdom all in one sweet package. Now, you can use technology as well to speed up natural processes. So this is basalt. It's a volcanic rock. You can find it more or less everywhere on Earth. And it naturally takes up CO2 in a process called chemical weathering. Unfortunately, it takes thousands of years to do it. But you can speed up the process if you grind up the rock and spread it on fields. And then you can speed it up to just a couple of years. And like biochar, it's good for the soil. You get minerals in the soil where you need them. And when it washes off into the sea, it can also help with another big bugbear of climate change, ocean acidification. And if we did this on 2/3 of the world's croplands, we could potentially take up to 4 billion tons of carbon from the atmosphere every year, which is a very big chunk of what we need. Now, these approaches so far, like planting trees, take a lot of land to be able to get them to scale. But there is one approach where you can actually do it in a very small amount of land, but still get to scale. It's called direct air capture. And it basically involves massive electric fans blowing a lot of air over a carbon capture device. Now, okay, this does look like a big futuristic machine, I admit that. But it's still marrying technology with a natural process, geology, because when you've captured the CO2, you bury it deep underground. Now, this is an artist's impression of a plant that's being designed by Carbon Engineering in Texas. Its aim is that it will take up 1 million tons of CO2 from the atmosphere every year. And I love this bit. Where does it go? They put it deep underground in the same geological formations that the Texas soil was originally squeezed out of. I love the poetry of this. It's like reversing the valve and putting the CO2 back where it came from. And recent studies have shown that if you do that, 98% of it will still be there in 10,000 years. When you put it down, it stays down. Now, this is still a little bit futuristic. It's still in the planning and design stages. But this carbon capture plant started operating this year. It's smaller scale, but it's already doing it. This is Climeworks and Carbfix in Iceland. They're using geothermal heat to power it, and they're putting the CO2 into the Icelandic basaltic rock. So one issue, though, with direct air capture is it takes a lot of energy to power those fans. And that energy obviously has to be green. It has to be clean. You can't use fossil fuels for it. But it also makes it much more expensive than other techniques. And it takes energy to cook wood and to grind rock. And so all of those approaches I'm talking about are currently much more expensive than planting trees. But we can do something about that. We can invest in it now, do the research and development, and get them down the cost curve to make them affordable. It worked for solar power, it worked for wind, it can work for carbon removals too. And remember, we have to get to very big scale, billions of tons of carbon removals by 2050. And that means we have to start now. The UN High-Level Champions for Climate Action have set a target of 100 million tons of removals by 2030. And today, we've only got a few. And that's already a big step up. But we can all help by reducing our emissions as much as possible and figuring out how to remove the rest. Now, I'm not talking conventional offsets. You know, I put a ton of CO2 in the air, and I pay you not to put your ton in the air, but my ton's still there. Now, what I mean is, I put a ton of CO2 in the air, I pay someone to take a ton out of the air, either now or in the near future, and we can get to zero and beyond. What goes up must now come down. And if we all do that, if we all make that commitment, then the people trying to make removals happen will have the finance and the courage and the confidence to be able to get to the scale that we need. I don't know which of all of these approaches, in the end, are going to be the ones that we're going to have to use to get us to the scale we need. But I do know that we're going to need a whole spread of them, with nature and technology working hand in hand to take CO2 out of the sky and keep it out. Which brings me neatly back to the woolly pigs. Now, these woolly pigs live on an estate on the Isle of Mull, which is owned by Jim Mann's Future Forest Company. And I know they don't look very dangerous, but they are actually the closest you can get to a native Scottish wild boar without having to have a dangerous animal's license. And they do what the Scottish wild boars used to do. They rootle up the undergrowth left over from selective grazing. They let the seed bank come to the surface so that native trees can start to grow and start to take up CO2 from the sky. Well, they're also planting trees in this lovely place, native broadleaf like oak and this beech tree. And it's plenty wet enough on the Isle of Mull that they're not likely to burn. So that's so far so natural. But they also have machines. This one is getting ready to cook wood for biochar to go on the soils. And they've also got a quarry with basalt, the quarrying basalt rock. They've got machines to grind up the rock, and they've got machines to spread it on the fields. That's three carbon removals approaches in one beautiful place. Now, it's just one estate, But all of these approaches and more are hugely scalable. The world is full of places where you can plant trees and put carbon in soil and grind up rock and spread it and capture CO2 from the air and find places to store it underground, all of those things. And there's hundreds, thousands of people working right now to get those carbon removals approaches out of the textbook and into practice, and to help us, God help us, reverse the damage we have done and start the process of climate healing. And when I sat on that hillside and I saw the pigs rootling and the trees growing and the machines getting ready to cook and grind, I loved it, because I experienced an emotion that those of us who work on climate change very rarely experience. I felt hope. Thank you.
Thank you, Gabrielle. So the next guest is one of the foremost living sci-fi authors. He wrote books like The Mars Trilogy, New York 2140, and the recent The Ministry for the Future, which I know has actually been read by several people involved in organizing COP26. He gave a TED talk a few months ago, which you can see on the TED website. And it was framed as a letter from 2071, 50 years ahead, telling the history of how humanity came together to solve the climate crisis and to restore the damage that has been done to the Earth's biosphere. An ambitious vision, a positive vision. I want to discuss the book and other things and COP26 with Stan, he's here, Kim Stanley Robinson. Stan, sci-fi writer at COP26, what are you doing here, really?
Well, I'm figuring that out as this week has gone on and next week goes on. And it occurred to me a couple of times that a giant organization, 40,000 people, come together to plan the future. Why would you want a science fiction writer? It actually seems to be an obvious thing, because COP26 itself is a science fiction exercise. Any story set in the future is a science fiction story by definition. So it can be done as a group thing, a massive multiple role-playing game, which is the group here, and planning the future in meticulous detail with some teeth in it. Not only particulars, but with some legal requirements and treaty obligations that are going to come out of it to actually make it happen. So it isn't just a story, but a plan. So I don't know. I mean, I've been saying this. Everybody is a science fiction writer. Everybody plans their own future individually and then hopes for their family, their towns. The mental operation of thinking through the futures, scenario building, what have you, is just an expression of your hopes and your fears, and everybody does it. So I don't have any particular expertise except in the writing of novels, and I'm not sure. I guess what the novel would be doing here is that people having read Ministry for the Future, all the people that have worked their lives on these issues suddenly live a kind of a dream, the reading of the fiction. They think, well, it really could happen. And then it helps them to go on.
So the book tells essentially a story around a ministry, a real ministry, which is, as you imagine it, established under the Paris Agreement, and is tasked with helping implementing it and taking care of future generations. Give us the core message of the book for those who have not read it.
Sure. By way of the Paris Agreement, one is you take that as a given, as the enabling device for the fiction to work. You imagine that what the Paris Agreement set in motion actually does work. You take the best case, the best possible case that you can still believe in, which will include a lot of trouble, a lot of resistance, a lot of accidental and on-purpose problems along the way, and yet ultimately you begin to bring down the curve of CO2 in the atmosphere, and you begin to dodge the mass extinction event that we're on the brink of. Can that story be told in a way that you can believe in as a reader? That's what the book was an experiment on.
The fact that you put at the center of the book a new international organization, are you suggesting that existing institutions and organizations look insufficient? We need actually a new international body as a tool for this?
Well, only in this sense. The Ministry for the Future is like a symbol for the Congress of the Parties, for the Paris Agreement, the international treaty system that is the UN and the IPCC. The Paris Agreement does give the Congress of the Parties the right to set up permanent standing subcommittees to work on problems that don't seem to be getting solved year to year. So there's a technical device that enables the invention of this ministry. It's not that new. It's sort of standing in. And I now think that actually it isn't just UN, IPCC. Many people around the world are working in ways that make them think that they're in a kind of a ministry for the future already. And they're right about that. So it's essentially a symbol for an already existing process. And I'll add this. We're in a nation state system. We're in a global capitalist system. Neither of those systems is well suited for dealing with the planetary biosphere crisis. And indeed, they're sometimes implicated in the creation of that very same crisis. So, but they're the tools that we have. So using the tools that we have, can we save the planetary biosphere? This is an open question. But I don't think we can invent new tools. I think we don't have enough time. We have to adapt the tools that we have, the mechanisms we've already invented, and make them work.
So I don't want to spoil the book for those who have not read it, but it starts with a cataclysmic weather event in India, which kills literally millions of people and triggers a series of political and climate actions and reactions. Now, we've been surrounded for years, and every year more so, and especially the last couple of years, by wildfire and floods and heat waves, which do feel really catastrophic, although not at the level you describe in the book. And yet there seems to be an insufficient sense of urgency and crisis. Do you think that we need to go to that kind of catastrophic event to really prompt action?
No, I don't think so. And a new acquaintance of mine said it this morning, you don't have to go through a plane crash to want to not be in a plane crash. The imagination is enough. And when I read about the wet bulb 35 temperatures being fatal to human beings over a matter of hours, and that we were quickly approaching them, and this is a heat humidity index, and I have no problem with the spoilers that in the beginning of my novel I portray that happening, that was a painful scene to write, and I am terrified that something like it could happen in the real world. We can already imagine it, and we need to avoid it by way of seeing it coming down on us. So no, and also people are so good at thinking, well, it will never happen to me. So I think really the shift is mental, that we have to realize that even if it doesn't happen to us, it could, and it's going to happen unless we try to avoid it.
So one of my reading of the book is that it's a book about money. It's a book about how do we pay ourselves to do the right thing instead of paying ourselves to extract and destruct and so on. And money has been a big item even at COP here this week, right? Prime Minister Modi talked about trillions, and the Prime Minister of Barbados talked about trillions, and banks came out talking about trillions. So these are all, the stuff that's been discussed here is all about shifting existing money somewhere else. You, in the book, invent a new kind of money, a new kind of currency, the carbon coin. Explain what it is.
Sure. Again, I would say that it's somewhat of a symbol, like the way the Ministry for the Future is a symbol for this whole process that we're in. The carbon coin. Think about the quantitative easing of 2008 and of 2020. The central banks of the world can create new money that they then inject into the system to keep liquidity, keep the economy going. If the first spending of that money that has been newly created is devoted specifically to decarbonization work, and then entered the general economy with a kind of multiplier effect, as Keynes used to call it, then that would be the trillions. And I think we are now in a period of experiment where we're going to have to test out how much new money can be created and spent on decarbonization without damaging people's trust in money itself, which would be inflation or deflation. That you cannot predict in advance. Economics is not sharp enough as a science to be able to say that. It's more like weather predicting. We're going to have to try it and see. But if really trillions per year is necessary, trillions do exist that could be targeted in that direction. Since it's not the highest rate of return for business as we've been defining it, then this original creation of money by the central banks that dedicated to it, it's not that different really than from legislation, also targeting bills and saying we're going to pay for these things. So again, it's not revolutionary. I didn't invent it. It's in the literature. Sometimes it's called carbon quantitative easing. Sometimes it's called the carbon reward. I just pictured it happening, how it would happen, what the resistances would be, what the successes would be.
So the idea is central banks together issue carbon coins, and the carbon coins go to whoever sequesters, removes, or reduces emissions in a proven, certifiable, verifiable, long-term, consistent way. And that's the way to get money into the system while pushing for the right thing to be done.
Yeah, actually, I think there's two things going on that are conflated together. The carbon coin or carbon reward is if you sequester carbon and you're anything from an individual to a city to a nation state, and including even the petrostates, which is a fairly radical stretch of the logical, following the logic of this situation, you keep carbon in the ground or bring it down into the ground, you get paid by the central banks. It's not a cryptocurrency. It's hard money that can be translated into US dollars or anything as solid as that. Then there's carbon quantitative easing, which isn't quite the same, which is the government's saying we need to spend this billion on decarbonization. We'll pay you for it. What's your project? In the way that government legislates things and the way that grants are brought out by federal agencies. So both those things could be called the carbon coin, but they're somewhat distinct.
Now, they appear in your novel, but just because they sound like futuristic and sci-fi, these are actually actual discussions that are happening in some back rooms and boardrooms and academic research centers today.
Absolutely. In fact, I only found out about this after I finished my book. I was quite shocked, but in a good way. The Network for Greening the Financial System is an organization of 89 central banks that are a kind of large discussion group amongst themselves. What can we do to green fiscal and monetary policy? And they have nine suggestions they put out in a white paper. They kind of resemble the carbon coin, or the carbon coin is a symbol for them. Then also, I think now, this is a Mark Carney thing, the G-Feds. The Federal Reserve banks of the G20 or the G7, it could even be if we could just get the G2 of US and China together, those central banks supporting green infrastructure build-outs would be the way to fund what is not necessarily profitable in the current ways that we measure profit, but we have to do them, so they have to be paid for. So this is, as I say, I'm just a... my science fiction is a kind of a looking at what's happening right now and then just putting it in the future and pointing it out to people.
So in the book, there are moments where airplanes fall from the sky and some people die. There is a sort of violence attached to the climate discussion that emerges, and some eco-terrorism. It sounds, I assume you are not proposing it nor endorsing it, but it sounds like you expect it to happen, things to get violent at some point.
Well, I wanted again to tell the story as a kind of shock to the readers. If we don't solve the climate change problem, there are going to be people at the sharp end of the stick, and they're going to be very, very angry. And they're going to want revenge and retribution as well as justice. So again, we can imagine this in advance and try to solve it by peaceful means ahead of time. There's an interesting discussion going on amongst the climate change activist crowds right now that you really ought to pay attention to, because it's intellectually stimulating. Basically, the absolute pacifist, nonviolent resistance is the main thing that works, and this has been shown in the social science literature. On the other hand, if the powerful are afraid of violence, or if people are even gluing themselves to doors, you have passive resistance, you have active resistance, you have sabotage, then you have murder. On that scale of activities, there are distinctions to be made, even amongst citizens of the developed world. At what point do you act? And you can follow this discussion as well. In my novel, I would say it's a mess. It's a mess like history itself. My novel is not a good device for thinking through these issues. It's more like a case study of let's avoid the mess.
So you wrote an op-ed for Business Bloomberg Green before coming to COP. And you imagine, in part of it, the delegates attending COP46, 20 years from now, and kind of looking back at today, and maybe with gratitude, maybe not. Based on what you've seen in the last few days here, how do you think they're going to look back?
Good question. I can't tell you. It's too big to understand. It's my first COP, and I'm overwhelmed. But I guess I would say this. The meeting itself is a success. The whole world is watching. The sense of intensity since the IPCC report of August and since the pandemic, there's a rising sense that we have got to do something, and in meetings like this are one of the best ways we have to coordinate it worldwide. So people will be complaining when this meeting's over, oh, it's this whole thing about blah, blah, blah. Actually, these are international diplomats who are working out the languages of laws and treaties that are going to bind us to action. We've got nothing else. It's not blah, blah, blah. It's law. It's figuring out the details. I like sitting in the sessions that are where the negotiations are going on and they're deciding whether to put their tables in columns or rows. I fully love these because this is language work that will translate into law, that will translate into actions. And so I'm going to say COP26 will go down in history. Glasgow will be one of the ones that sticks out, like Copenhagen, Kyoto, Paris. Glasgow's going to stick out. So it'd be nice if we could, you know, if the whole crowd of us could make it be good.
Stan, thank you for taking the time and for being with us.
Thank you. Thanks for everything.
Wonderful, thank you. Well, it's time to talk about China. China, of course, is the world's largest emitter of greenhouse gas emissions, even though places like Europe, the US, and elsewhere are bigger in terms of per capita emissions. And it's a country of contradictions. It's both the world leader in solar, but also the world leader in coal. So to try to decode and make sense of China's climate policies, we invited a climate journalist to put together a talk for us to decode and make sense of where China is heading. I'm delighted to welcome Hongqiao Liu.
Last year, China's leader Xi Jinping made a historic pledge to fight global warming. China will strive to peak carbon dioxide emissions before 2030 and achieve carbon neutrality before 2060. But what do those commitments actually mean? First, let's consider the magnitude of these pledges. They call for domestic climate actions at an unprecedented speed and scale. Due to the size of China, they will also matter globally. China is as large as the US, with four times the population. With double-digit annual economic growth in the past 40 years, China has become the world's second-largest economy. China has become the world's second-largest economy in 2010. And the story of China being the world's largest emitter is a fairly recent one. When I was born, and you can see I'm not that old, the emissions in China was only half those of the US. It only became the largest about 15 years ago. In 2019, China represents 28% of global CO2 emissions. Its emissions are so significant today that going net zero before 2060 could prevent a 0.2 to 0.3 degree of global warming and bring down 215 billion tons of CO2 emissions in the next 40 years. And that is equivalent to its cumulative emissions in the past half century. So, Why do China emit so much? The phenomenal economic growth in China, like in many developed countries, were primarily driven by fossil fuels. In 2020, 84% of China's emissions. In 2020, 84% of China's primary energy consumption came from the fossil fuels. The thirst for energy has made it the world's largest coal consumer, the second largest oil consumer, and the single largest contributor to the demand, to the growth in demand for gas. But there's another side to the story. In the past decade, China has also seen the world's fastest and the largest deployment of almost anything clean, green, and low carbon. And that includes a long list of number ones in the field of non-fossil energy, low carbon transportation, green buildings, and you just name it. In July 2021, China launched the world's largest emissions trading scheme. The single act has now put a carbon price to 12% of global CO2 emissions. China is also the largest producer and the processor of a few critical minerals used for clean energy technologies. It also manufactures the world's most wind turbines and solar panels. According to Cambridge Econometrics, a UK-based consultancy, the huge scale of investment required for net zero China before 2060 could create a positive spillover effect on other countries, bringing down the cost of clean energy all around the world. And such an effect has already been observed in the cost of solar panels. But the road to net zero will not be an easy one. As China's leader Xi Jinping said himself, China must make extraordinarily hard efforts. One of the reasons is the much shorter time span, as Xi put it. China has pledged to peak its emissions in the next 9 years. It's worth noting, however, this is considered as highly insufficient by climate action tracker independent scientific analysis for the consistency to 3 to 4 degree warmer climate. China should also bring down 10 to 11 billion tons of annual CO2 emissions at its peak level to net zero in about 30 years. That's my age, by the way. This will take that will take the nations of the EU about 60, 70 years. However, unlike the EU, China faces a dual challenge. In 2020, there are 600 million people living in China with a monthly income of about $140 or less. China wants to become a great socialist modern country, which translates to continuous urbanization and modernization. Any tiny improvement that lifts up the living standard of an average Chinese person must be multiplied by 1.4 billion. And that could mean a lot more emissions. Another challenge is transforming the economic structure. In 2020, 38% of China's GDP came from the secondary industry. Many of them are considered as Liangao industries in China, which means dual high. That's high in energy consumption and high in emissions. These industries include coal power and the manufacturing of iron, steel, cement, aluminum, chemicals, petrochemicals, you know, the hard to abate industries you've heard of. And according to the International Energy Agency, the power and the industry combined add up to 84% of the nation's total CO2 emissions. For decades, China has been the so-called factory of the world. The emissions generated from such production, known as embedded carbon, are calculated as domestic emissions in China rather than be ascribed to countries that import Chinese-made products. But regardless of all these challenges, China has made its pledge. So how can China get there? China has pledged that it will not build any coal power plants abroad, and it will start to phase out coal consumption starting from the 15th five-year plan period. That's 2026 onwards. It's greening up the energy structure and ramping up electrification. According to experts from Tsinghua University, electricity can meet 79% of China's final energy consumption by 2060 if net zero is achieved, and that's almost triple today's level. The industry sectors we just talked about are also going through structural reform, fuel switching, and technology upgrades, including starting pilots such as hydrogen-fueled steelmaking and the so-called negative emissions technologies. You're familiar with that, you know, carbon capture, storage, that type of thing. And the world China already has the world's largest installed capacity for wind and solar. It has committed to double it over the next 9 years. A high-level review compiled by Energy Foundation China on China's pathway to 2 degree and 1.5 degree concludes that most scenarios project China to peak its emissions before the pledged deadline of 2030. It could be even be before 2025. The city of Beijing has already done that about 10 years ago, and many high-emitting provinces have also shown a sign of a slowdown. Experts such as Zhou Ji, a veteran environmental economist, believes that compared to Western countries, China can achieve its climate pledges at a lower per capita income, and more crucially, a shorter plateau to its emissions peak once it is achieved. The China's leadership holds a clear view that the country must move away from the GDP-oriented pattern that pollutes then trades to what it calls an ecological civilization. Since 2010, China almost doubled its GDP per capita, while largely maintaining a steady level of emissions per capita. And finally, let me give you just one example of how this vision is implemented. In June 2021, China decided to clamp down hard on the power-hungry mining of cryptocurrencies. Half of the world's capacity disappeared almost overnight. Of course, to peak emissions before 2030 at a lower level, China must clamp down. Of course, to peak emissions before 2030 at a lower level, China must limit the unconstrained development of the Liangao industries. Recently, hundreds of such new projects have been put on pause, waiting for new assessments on their impact on carbon emissions. And the hope is that this type of change will not be linear, but instead follow a more exponential path. As Zhou Ji noted, transformation might seem slow in the beginning, like turning around a giant ship. But once the head is turned, actions can accelerate in the right direction at an unprecedented speed. Thank you.
I'm delighted to say for those of you here in the room that Hongqiao is here with us. And where's she gone? Is she here? Yes, there we go, at the back. Hongqiao, thank you. And we'll be happy to chat to you at the end. So we have one more special surprise guest who I'm thrilled to welcome. She is an extraordinary young climate activist. She's also the youngest member of the youth advisory group appointed by the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres. Sophia Chiani, please come and join us on the stage. She did a fabulous talk. She's walking up this beautiful ramp. She did a fabulous talk, which will be out shortly, that we shared just 3 weeks ago. Come and stand with me. We'll stand. So Sophia, brilliant to have you here. And one of the things I just wanted to ask you, well, first of all, let's start with COP. Here we are, end of day six. I know you've had an intense time. You've been out and about all over the place. Give people a sense of what you make of this week so far and what's standing out for you.
Well, I think speaking from personal experience, one of my highlights at COP so far has been we got to have our first in-person meeting with the UN Secretary General. So that was very cool, and we were able to kind of share reflections on what young people think going into COP. And I think that there's been a lot of disillusionment by young people where it's like we've been locked out of these decision-making spaces. And so often, even though we want to make our voices heard, we feel like there aren't structures and institutions in place to be able to do that. And so I think that in the next week until the end of negotiations, we'll see whether or not progress is made, but I do think we need to focus on solutions and seeing how we can get better. I saw that, like, a recent report said that if all the current pledges are kept, then we'll limit global warming to 1.8 degrees. And yes, that's not where we need to be, but it's significant progress.
And just speaking a little bit more about youth, I mean, one of the things that I'm hearing a lot of here, and perhaps people watching will be interested in, is there is a bit of a different feeling here in terms of engagement, actually, from the private sector, from civil society, from science, that there's just a different sense of energy. I don't know how whether you've been to COPs before, but, well, I guess you have. But
I haven't.
You haven't. Okay. So here you are, you know, really making your mark. Do you feel that youth, I mean, that meeting with Antonio Guterres, that youth is being included in different ways? Is that, should we recognize that shift is now well underway?
I think, unfortunately, situations like the one that I was in are the exception, but not the rule. And so I think that even though there have been spaces created for young people to engage in smaller discussions with world leaders and to get our perspectives heard, too often it's the same young people over and over who get these opportunities. And it's like there is a huge group of the young people who go out and strike every single day. They're left out of these spaces and they're not able to engage in these conversations. So I think that progress has been made. I don't think, obviously, like 5-10 years ago, there wasn't this potential for direct dialogue between youth activists like me and world leaders. So progress has been made, but I think there's still so much left to do.
Great. Now, Sophia, you've started an extraordinary organization, which is the subject of your TED Talk, the Climate Cardinals. I'd love you to tell people what motivated you to start it and what do you do?
Yeah, of course. So this is exactly what I talked about in my TED Talk. But basically, I'm Iranian American. Both of my parents are from Iran. And so I took a trip to Iran in middle school. And when I was there, I was struck by how horrible pollution was. And I started to read about climate change in the Middle East. I learned that it was disproportionately impacting the Middle East and Iran. And so I started to talk to my relatives about the issue of climate change. And I realized they knew almost nothing. And the reason why is because there was a severe lack of climate resources available in Farsi, which is Iran's native language. And so I started by translating climate resources with my mom. So it was a two-person job. And then I started my nonprofit, Climate Cardinals, and we worked to translate climate resources into over 100 languages. And so we've been able to translate hundreds of thousands of words of climate information into over 100 languages, which is great progress from where me and my mom began.
And give us a sense of how that actually works in practice. How are you reaching people? A sense of the impact that you're already having in terms of people accessing materials that they previously couldn't read.
Yeah, so I think some of the most significant work we've done so far is by virtue of being on the UN Youth Advisory Group, I've been able to connect with a lot of different UN partners. And so we translated that huge report that came out by UNICEF that said like 1 billion people have felt, 1 billion children will feel the impacts of climate change. We translated that into multiple indigenous and African languages. We actually today finished translating the Youth for Climate Manifesto that we created like 3 weeks ago in Italy into the 6 UN languages. And so we are doing translations for these groups that have large platforms that are able to disseminate information out there, but now they're able to make it a lot more accessible and inclusive.
Right. I mean, part of what I love about your work is getting into this how you're making stuff happen on an extraordinary scale. So I just want to hugely appreciate what you're doing and
what your
team are doing. And can we just have a round of applause for Sophia's work? It's fantastic. Now, our next speaker, our last speaker before we finish with a beautiful piece of art, is also another extraordinary woman, and I would love you to introduce her if you would.
Yeah, I'm so honored to introduce our next speaker. And first, I want to give a bit of context. So Indigenous people, they protect 1/3 of our world's land, but too often they find their rights completely ignored, if not disrespected, and their homes have been destroyed, especially because of rampant deforestation. And so our next speaker, she's from Ecuador, and she's going to be speaking from her home in the rainforest, and she's going to be speaking in Spanish with... Thanks to translations, we will have subtitles. So please welcome our next speaker, Nemonte Nenquimo.
Thank you.
Mi nombre es Nemonte Nenquimo, soy mujer. Guaurani, madre, líder de mi pueblo. Cuando yo era joven, primera vez salí a la ciudad de escuela misionera para poder aprender español. Yo nunca tuve la oportunidad para ir a la universidad, pero yo tengo a los piquenanis, a los sabios que me han enseñado de tener ese conocimiento, de respetar, de tener amor a la selva. Y de eso me ha crecido de ser líder. La selva es nuestro maestro, maestra. Los piquenanis, los sabios, mujeres, tanto hombres, sabios, son nuestro científico, nuestro maestro, que nos ha enseñado, y ese valor, ese conocimiento, ese amor tenemos. Pero lo que decimos como pueblos indígenas, ese valor se han perdido la gente de afuera. La selva es nuestra casa. La selva nos da toda la vida a nosotros, la comida, alimentación, agua, conexión espiritual. Pero la llegada de carretera, la llegada de colonización, la llegada de evangélicos, la llegada de petrolera, nos ha destruido nuestra selva. Y conocí a otros indígenas que viven en el norte, que ellos fueron primer contacto con la colonización, invasiones, carreteras. Es muy triste. La gente que están mirando, escuchando, me gustaría decir que nuestra Amazonía sigue quemando en el bosque, el petróleo sigue derramando y el minero sigue entrando en nuestro territorio, robando nuestros oros, y las colonizaciones siguen invadiendo para talar y alimentar a sociedades de afuera. Eso quiero hacer conocer a nosotros directamente, nos está perjudicando, nos están arriesgando la vida de nuestros pueblos amazónicos en todo el país. Nosotros como pueblos indígenas hemos venido luchando a esa tierra por miles de años porque tenemos mucho amor y respetamos. Por eso es importante que escuchen nuestras voces, nuestros gritos, nuestros lloros, para que no vaya más a perjudicar en nuestra selva, porque ustedes no están escuchando. Más del 25% superficie de la tierra está protegido de los pueblos indígenas. Esto incluye casi la mitad del bosque del mundo. Yo pienso que la gente de afuera, que decimos nosotros como mujeres indígenas, que son gente cure, conocen menos en la selva. Por eso a ellos no les importa la vida de la selva, no les importa la vida del espiritual, no les importa la vida de que cómo nosotros vivimos conectados por miles de años respetando a la madre tierra. Por eso es importante como mujer. Digo, de ese aprendizaje que como mujer joven he aprendido, que la vida que curen piensa que es la tecnología, desarrollo es mejor, pero no tiene conciencia que a la vez están destruyendo el planeta. Y si siguen esos como ciegos, nosotros decimos la gente menos que conocen la selva son ciegos. Nosotros como indígenas somos que estamos abiertos los ojos, sabemos lo que está pasando. Core es para nosotros un extraño que no valora, que no tiene conocimiento hacia los bosques. ¿Qué significa bosque para nosotros? Para el pueblo Guarani, el bosque significa es nuestra casa, nuestra vida, lleno de vida, lleno de conocimientos. Tú puedes caminar, ahora puedes caminar, estoy viendo yo alrededor las plantas que podemos comer, las hojas que podemos curar. Bejuco podemos utilizar para nuestros canastos, para cargar. Madera para hacer construir la casa, buena madera. Las hojas para dolor de cabeza. Pero si yo traigo a un cure, cure no va a pensar como yo estoy viendo. Cure no tiene ese conocimiento. Piensa que ahí es un regalo, un lugar de recursos, están sacando. La palabra cure no tiene que ser malo. Ustedes son capaces de tener ese valor, el conocimiento que tenemos nosotros como pueblos amazónicos en general. Pueden aprender, pueden respetar, pueden aliarse con nosotros. Nosotros como pueblos indígenas no necesitamos la imagen de satélites porque estamos viviendo en la selva y sabemos lo que está pasando en la selva quemando en la Amazonía. Los petroleros vienen a nuestro territorio a decir que el petrolero es como un desarrollo para el país, un cambio para apoyar en las comunidades, pero no va a perjudicar. Vienen con bonitas palabras que no se va a afectar en medio ambiente, ni el agua, ni, ni alrededor de la selva. Pero es mentira. Nosotros estamos viviendo con carne propia, con otros pueblos que el petróleo ha traído derrames por meses. No han podido los petroleros mismos limpiar. Se han dejado contaminar nuestros peces, nuestros ríos, nuestros espirituales. Nuestra gente, nuestros pueblos se han enfermado. Si decimos como pueblo indígena, no queremos consulta, no queremos explotación, el gobierno debe respetar y retirar. No tiene que ir encima, aunque los comunidades, los bases dicen no y no hacen, como no se escuchan, ponen ciego, ponen sordo y están llegando. Y eso quiere decir que no está respetando nuestro derecho de la vida, del derecho de la naturaleza y está matando. Y por eso nosotros pedimos otra vez, exigimos al gobierno que escuche nuestras voces, nuestras decisiones. Lo que pasa que en nuestra selva es nuestra casa y punto. Queremos que escuchen, queremos que ya no consuman petróleo, ya no consuman la comida que talan bosques hasta miles, millones de hectáreas, porque están perjudicando, están matando nuestros espíritus, nuestra vida, nuestra selva, nuestra farmacia, y dónde vamos a dar agua para nuestros hijos en futuras generaciones, para nuestros hijos y para vuestros hijos también. Lo que hacemos nosotros, lo que amamos, lo que respetamos, no es solamente para el pueblo, la vida del pueblo es indígena, sino la vida de ustedes, de todo el mundo que estamos viviendo, estamos arriesgando. Queremos que escuchen y despierten y que deciden ya basta, que no entre más en nuestro territorio explotación y contaminación. Yo pediría a ustedes, para llegar, los pueblos indígenas en general, hemos tenido un amor profundo, un verdadero respeto por miles de años a esa selva. Pero tampoco no puedo enseñar toda esa etapa para que ustedes sepan qué es el respeto, qué es la conexión con la tierra, con el espiritual. Lo que yo pido es que respeten. La Madre Tierra está esperando que respetemos. La Madre Tierra no está esperando que salvemos nosotros. Y nosotros como pueblos indígenas esperamos lo mismo.
And so to finish this session and to finish the countdown at COP26 program, we're going to go to upstate New York. There's a farm there, it's called Soulfire Farm. There lives an astonishing poet, and she's going to recite for us her poem, Being Human, Naima Penniman.
I wonder if the sun debates dawn some mornings, not wanting to rise out of bed from under the down feather horizon. If the sky grows tired of being everywhere at once, adapting to the mood swings of the weather. If clouds drift off, trying to hold themselves together, make deals with gravity to loiter a little longer. I wonder if rain is scared of falling, if she has trouble letting go, if snowflakes get sick of being perfect all the time, each one trying to be one of a kind. I wonder if stars wish upon themselves before they die, if they need to teach their young how to shine. I wonder if shadows long to just for once feel the sun, if they get lost in the shuffle, not knowing where they're from. I wonder if sunrise and sunset respect each other, even though they've never met. If storms have regrets, if volcanoes get stressed, if compost believes in life after death. I wonder if breath ever thinks of suicide, if the wind just wants to sit still sometimes and watch the world pass him by, If smoke was born, knowing how to rise. If rainbows get shy backstage, not sure if their colors match rights. I wonder if lightning needs an alarm clock to know when to crack. If rivers ever stop and think of turning back. If streams meet the wrong sea and their whole lives run off track. I wonder if the snow wants to be black, if the soil thinks she's too dark, if butterflies want to cover up their marks, if rocks are self-conscious of their weight, if mountains are insecure of their strength. I wonder if waves get discouraged, crawling up the sand, only to be pulled back again to where they began. If land feels stepped upon, if sand feels insignificant, if trees need to question their lovers to know where they stand, if branches waver at the crossroads unsure of which way to grow, if leaves understand they're replaceable and they still dance when the wind blows. I wonder where the moon goes when she is in hiding. I want to find her there and watch the ocean spin from a distance, listen to her stir in her sleep. Effort give way to existence.
Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us. Those of you here, wishing the rest of the team a wonderful, successful second week at COP26.
And thank you also to those who have been watching online. So most of the talks of tonight have not yet been released on TED.com. They're going to be released over the next few weeks. But others are there from the World Countdown Initiative. Over the last 2 years, they have created about 85 different talks. So TED.com is the place if you want to see some of them. Big solutions, contextual information, and more. Thank you again for coming, and enjoy the rest of the evening. Goodbye.
Thank you and goodbye.